Greetings, friends. One other brief thing about Seinfeld is that the show, I used to tape it when it first came on from 89 till 92 or so. And that was how different it was at the time and how much I liked it. I used to do a lot of taping with VHS back in the day. And that was before it was realized that it had before it became a big hit. Someone mentioned the Nine Circles of Hell in a chat that I was in recently, and it got me curious, and I have started to try to read Dante's Inferno on occasion, and have never really made it very far, but this is a relatively short section and very interesting. I've heard people say that what people are talking about when they talk about hell is actually Dante's Inferno. There's little to nothing about hell in the Bible, and I've heard other people say that hell is actually not, it's not the bad place that it's made out to be. It's just part of the inner earth. So, be that as it may, Inferno, the first part of Dante's Divine Comedy that inspired the latest Dan Brown's bestseller of the same title, describes the poet's vision of hell. The story begins with the narrator, who is the poet himself, being lost in a dark wood where he is attacked by three beasts which he cannot escape. He is rescued by the Roman poet Virgil, who is sent by Beatrice, Dante's ideal woman. Together, they begin the journey into the underworld, or the nine circles of hell. And what you might want to do is play this for your friends and family at some of the holiday dinners. Kidding. First circle, limbo. Now, what I know about limbo is that it's a game that I used to play when roller skating and other things, where you keep trying to see how low you can stoop under something. That's pretty much my whole experience with that. The first circle of hell is resided by virtuous non-Christians and unbaptized pagans who are punished with the eternity, an inferior form of heaven. They live in a castle with seven gates, which symbolize the seven virtues. Here Dante sees many prominent people from classical antiquity, such as Homer, Socrates, Aristotle, Cicero, Hippocrates, and Julius Caesar. I wonder if this Dante was tripping balls like so many of the people that have written some of the great works like Alice in Wonderland and Lewis Carroll and many other ones. Virtuous non-Christians and unbaptized pagans. Unbaptized pagan, that seems like a screwed up idea, although I'm not really into there's so many things in society that are a ritual that you don't think about them being a ritual, but I know there's something to water, the whole water thing, and that's why they have baptism. It's the picture and symbology of wiping the old person away and bringing in a new person, a new soul. But I wonder what the actual definition that he is talking about of pagan there, because it's it's more than one, or it's certainly looked at more than one way. I know that. Second circle, lust. In the second circle of hell, Dante and his companion, Virgil, find people who were overcome by lust. They're punished by being blown violently back and forth by strong winds, preventing them from finding peace and rest. Strong winds symbolize the restlessness of a person who is led by the desire for fleshly pleasures. Again, Dante sees many notable people from history and mythology, including Cleopatra, Tristan, Helen of Troy, and others who were adulterous during their lifetime. That reminds me, just recently I was wishing that the desire for a woman, if it's not going to be, you know, fulfilled, why, I wish it could just go away, but that's just not the way that we're made. That's kind of a lascivious picture for something that would appear to be from antiquity, although there's plenty of that. Third circle, gluttony. When reaching the third circle of hell, Dante and Virgil find souls of gluttons who are overlooked by a worm monster, Cerberus. Sinners in this circle of hell are punished by being forced to lie in a vile slush that is produced by never-ending icy rain. The vile slush symbolizes personal degradation of one who overindulges in food, drink, and other worldly pleasures. While the inability to see others lying nearby represents the glutton's selfishness and coldness. Here Dante speaks to a character called Siaco, who also tells him that Guelphs, a faction supporting the Pope, will defeat and expel the Ghibellines, a fraction supporting the emperor to which Dante adhered from Florence, which happened in 1302 before the poem was written after 1308. What this makes me think about were these different lust, gluttony, etc., is that, again, the Buddha calls us or recommends to us ever so subtly that it is the middle way that you want, not in the sense of sitting on a fence, not choosing, but moderation and temperance and patience and that sort of thing, rather than giving in to these negative things. Fourth circle, greed. In the fourth circle of hell, Dante and Virgil see the souls of people who are punished for greed. They're divided into two groups, those who hoarded possessions and those who lavishly spent it. Jousting. They use great weights as a weapon, pushing it with their chest, which symbolizes their selfish drive for fortune during their lifetime. The two groups that are guarded by a character called Pluto, probably the ancient Greek ruler of the underworld, are so occupied with their actions that the two poets don't try to speak to them. Here Dante says to see many clergymen, including cardinals and popes. Anger, which is can be a gift at times. The Bible, Jesus' character, as I think of him, says, "Be angry and sin not." So the subject of anger is certainly not a one-size thing, is what I'm saying. The fifth circle of hell is where the wrathful and sullen are punished for their sins, transported on a boat by Filigius. Dante and Virgil see the furious fighting each other on the surface of the river Styx and the sullen gurgling beneath the surface of the water. Again, the punishment reflects the type of sin committed during their lifetime. While passing through, the poets are approached by Filippo Argenti, a prominent Florentine politician who confiscated Dante's property after his expulsion from Florence. Sixth circle, heresy. When reaching the sixth circle of hell, Dante and Virgil see heretics who are condemned to eternity in flaming tombs. Here Dante talks with a couple of Florentines, Ferranita degli Uberti and Cavalcanti di Cavalcanti, or Santi. But he also sees other notable historical figures, including the ancient Greek philosopher Epicurus, Holy Roman Emperor Frederick II, and Pope Anastasius II. The latter, however, is, according to some modern scholars, condemned by Dante as a heretic by mistake. Instead, as some scholars argue, the poet probably meant the Byzantine Emperor Anastasius I. Seventh circle, violence. That just made me think about people who are really into video games. Not that that's necessarily always a bad thing, but just the way some people become so consumed with them and that's all they do, and you're working out a lot of times negative emotions with that sort of thing without even really realizing it, I think. Seventh circle of hell is divided into three rings. The outer ring houses murderers and others who were violent to other people and property. Here Dante sees Alexander the Great, disputed Dionysus I of Syracuse, Guy de Montfort, and many other notable historical and mythological figures, such as the Centaurus, sank into a river of boiling blood and fire. In the middle ring, the poet sees suicides who have been turned into trees and bushes which are fed upon by harpies. But he also sees here profligates chased and torn to pieces by dogs. In the inner ring are blasphemers and sodomites residing in a desert of burning sand and burning rain falling from the sky. Yeah, I wouldn't want to take sodomy into the... I don't know that we're judged in the way that people think, popularly think that you will, but it's all going to kind of come out somewhere, and in the way that in our transition, it's going to mean, it's, you know, what we do is going to mean something, and I'm just glad I'm not into that. It's a harpy is a ravenous, filthy monster having a woman's head and a bird's body. Scolding, nagging, bad-tempered woman, shrew. That was not a word that I was familiar with. That's why I looked it up. But he also sees here profligates chased and torn to pieces by dogs. In the inner ring are blasphemers and sodomites residing in a desert of burning sand and burning rain falling from the sky. Profligate, wildly extravagant, completely given up to dissipation and licentiousness. You know, that makes me think about, well, a number of different things. But what some homeless people might have been like before they got homeless. And then also how, I don't know if you've seen some of these stories where they are supposedly dumping buckets of diarrhea on people in California and stuff. I'm wondering if that's even true. I mean, I technically saw it on video, but I wonder if that could be something that they're making believe possibly that that's going on, so that it'll be easier when they start shipping more of them off to wherever they're probably eventually going to ship them off to. I've mentioned it before, but that's already happened in Columbia, South Carolina. They shipped the homeless people away somewhere. And then also, you know, every time I talk to a homeless person at any of these jobs here, there's always alcohol on their breath, and you know, people want to make, it seems like a lot of people have a real bleeding heart attitude towards them, and they want to defend them, and they're for the grace of God and blah blah blah. But and I mean, I give them things sometimes if I can, and I, like one day I found a pack of cigarettes in the store at this place I am now, and I saw one of them outside that's there every day, and I gave it to him. But I don't know. I mean, I have compassion for him, but it's a very hard situation to know what to think about. I've given them money before and other things. It's just a very, very hard thing. But I don't know how they even do it. I don't think I could do it. In the inner ring are blasphemers and sodomites, residing in deserts, burning sand, burning rain falling from the sky. Okay. The eighth circle, fraud. Oh, I can think of a lot of people in the public eye that will have that issue to deal with. The eighth circle of hell is resided by the fraudulent. Dante and Virgil reach it on back of Geryon, a flying monster with different natures, just like the fraudulent. This circle of hell is divided into 10 bulgeous, or stony ditches with bridges between them. In Bulgia 1, Dante sees panderers and seducer. In Bulgia 2, he finds flatterers. After crossing the bridge to Bulgia 3, he and Virgil see those who are guilty of simony. After crossing another bridge between the ditches to Bulgia 4, they find sorcerers and false prophets. I this is supposed to go straight to DuckDuckGo. I don't know how to fix it. It does all this. I hate that when you're trying to search for something and it just takes you to more searches. So yeah, I'm not going to find out what simony means at this time. In Bulgia 5 are housed corrupt politicians. In Bulgia 6 are hypocrites, and in the remaining 4 ditches, Dante finds Hippocrates, hypocrites, thieves, evil counselors and advisors, divisive individuals, and various falsifiers such as alchemists, perjurers, and counterfeits. I'm just racking my brain here to find out why he would have included alchemists in this, although that's a word that can take many different directions. I imagine he's meaning it as a people who turn other people's innocent desires into a profit for themselves without delivering on, or something like that. And then when he talked about flatterers here, it made me think about this guy that I know who is really full of it, but he keeps trying to like sell himself to me as far as like convincing me that he has my best interest at heart. It's just people, there's so much mental illness around that it's makes me understand why I just keep to myself and don't really have any friends, and why I'm generally quiet most of the time and don't really make the effort to try to move past it. So the ninth circle, treachery, the last ninth circle of hell, is divided into four rounds according to the seriousness of the sin. Though all residents are frozen in an icy lake, those who committed more severe sin are deeper within the ice. Each of the four rounds is named after an individual who personifies the sin. Thus, round one is named Cana, after Cain, who killed his brother Abel. Round two is named Antenera, after Antenor of Troy, who was Priam's counselor during the Trojan War. Round three is named Ptolemy, son of Ababus. While round four is named Judeca, after Judas Iscariot, the apostle who betrayed Jesus with a kiss. The link will be in the description, although you could find this many places. What I am thinking that I would like to do more is just chat like I see other people doing, but I need something to kind of jump off from. If these are do in fact end up being some of our last days on YouTube, I'm thinking it might not be quite as intense as some of us are thinking. I just heard recently that there's another thing where I guess it's maybe not going to even come into like full effect until January, even though they've told us December 10th, whatever. That will do it for now. Thank you for joining me, and I will undoubtedly talk to you